want to talk about a very special topic, very important topic, obviously to you, but throughout the country, and that is how we are urbanizing some parts, very small parts, of the suburbs. And you then link it with the fact that you happen to have a world-class university right here, really brings so many options that you can take advantage of. So we're talking about the future, of how we're building the built environment, and not just that, but how walkable urbanism could, if you choose, play a role here in Fairfax, both with the university and in your downtown. What are you really discussing today? You're talking about the built environment. The built environment is the infrastructure and the real estate, this building, your house, the university itself. The built environment totals 35% of the assets of the country. It's the largest asset class. If you took the capitalized value of all the New York Stock Exchange companies and all the NASDAQ companies and added them up and multiplied them by two, the built environment's larger. That's why we in real estate are very proud of the fact that of the last three recessions, we caused two of them. And I think you'll agree that this last time we really did it upright. The other thing, though, is that one of the reasons that this economy has been bumping along at roughly 2% growth for the last 5 years is that the built environment and the building of the built environment has in no way come back to where it should be. We're building 500,000 homes per year. It should be 1.5 million homes per year. We're only building one-third. And that is the primary reason that we're bumping along at 2% rather than the 3.54% that this economy really needs to drive down unemployment, expand economic growth. Now, it's very important when you're talking about the built environment to focus on transportation. You obviously heard that this morning. Because of the 15 infrastructure categories, transportation is first among equals. That transportation drives development. All my transportation friends love me when I say that. It is by far, for the 6,000 years we've been building cities, transportation dictates the form of the built environment and drives everything else. But there's only two ways of building the built environment, and therefore two fundamentally different transportation systems. One system we all know, and much of Fairfax has been built around it, which is, of course, highways. You build highways, and you get one form of the built environment, known as drivable suburban. In essence, we separate all land uses and we connect them by cars and trucks. And it's a perfectly, it's a great way to build. Much of Fairfax is built around that model. And it's, suburban splendor, it's lovely. The other way of building the built environment is when you have a portfolio, a medley of different transportation systems. Certainly cars still play a very major role, but rail transit, bus transit, bicycles. But once you're there, it's walkable. It's much more dense, at least 5 times, generally 10, 20, 30 times more dense than walkable suburban. Takes up very little space, as I'll show you in this region. The walkable urban places are about 6-7% of the total land mass, so it's not a lot of land. But within that land, you pack a lot of density, and once you're there, everything's walkable. So two ways of building the built environment. And this is not an either or discussion. It's a both and. The corollary to transportation driving development is that you do not build transportation systems to move people. That's not the goal. You build transportation systems for economic development. The means is moving people and goods. And we confuse that constantly in this country. And we just focus on moving people. The output, what we're trying to achieve, is great economic development. That's why we invested in the freeways. That's why we invested in the Beltway. That's why we invested in Metro. It's the economic development that's the outcome. And by confusing those two, we make some really, sometimes, pretty bad decisions that waste a lot of money. Now, the other major thing to understand is that the built environment is a reflection of the underlying economy. And back 50 years ago, this economy was obviously at the peak of the industrial age. 40 to 45% of all jobs, directly and indirectly, 50 years ago, was related to the raw material going into the manufacturing of the sales, the servicing, the insuring, the financing, building the roads for, fueling with oil, automobiles. So as you were seeing the USA in your Chevrolet, you wanted to drive everywhere and build drivable suburbia. It made us wealthier by building a drivable suburban place. That's why we did it. Prior to the Depression, we built walkable urban places primarily. After the Second World War, we pushed the pendulum all the way over and we were meeting the pent-up demand for drivable suburban places. And that's what we in real estate built. Now, the most important, and this will demonstrate the scholarly superiority of GW University, because I make my students watch popular movies. I know that sounds harsh, but the most important one is Back to the Future. This is the most important urban or urbanism movie that is popular because it shows the two ways of building the built environment in the same movie. And it shows it in three different periods of time. 1955, 1985, when the movie came out, and the near distant future. So I'd like to show you some clips where you can see walkable urbanism and drivable suburbanism as shown by Marty McFly. This idyllic downtown, a plaza similar to what you're now building, retail on the ground floor, office, residential up above, a reasonably dense, walkable urban place that you can get to many different ways, but once you're there, everything's walkable. Now, even in 1955, the seeds of change had been planted, of course. And this billboard is where Marty McFly parked his DeLorean. This billboard advertises his subdivision yet to be built where he was born in a drivable suburban manner. So, going to 1985, and you come back to downtown Hill Valley. X-rated movie theaters, homeless sleeping on a bench. Behind that homeless is the former town square, which has been paved over as a surface parking lot. So where is he going? He's going to the new center of town. And I think you know where that is. The new center of town, of course, is the Regional Mall. So the Regional Mall is that 20% of the land is built upon, 80% is surface parking lot. Next door is the business park where people work, and everything is driving. The only thing wrong with this little clip here is that Marty McFly is actually on foot going down that ramp. If it was during the day, he'd be run over. Nobody goes down that ramp on foot. We've engaged in this country in a similar way of building that you've been benefiting from for the last 50, 60 years. We've been pushing out in what's known as the favored quarter, the favored 90-degree arc coming out of downtown, and you're right on the southwest edge of the favored quarter as it's moving out from downtown DC. Every of the 383 metro areas, every one has a favored quarter where most job growth has gone, most of the regional malls have gone, most of the transportation infrastructure has gone. You're right in the favored quarter. And so initially, we built out edge cities. And it bypassed primarily the older suburban towns like you, that you, at least your downtown. And a lot of the retail left, went out to the regional malls. Then in the 90s into the early part of this century, we pushed growth even further out to what we now refer to as edgeless cities. In essence, in this country, as we grew, every 1% population growth, we had 6 to 8% land consumption, otherwise known as sprawl. Now, of course, we had lots of land. When we built out those inner suburban places, we just threw them away and just kept on moving out. So this is how, of course, we built in the 20th century. We started with freeways, of course, and subdivisions. then we invented the regional mall. This is King of Prussia Mall outside of Philadelphia, which is where I grew up. Then, of course, we got a lot better at building freeways, and we continue to push this further and further out to the edge. So this is how we've been building for many, many decades. But now fast forward to where we are today. The industrial age is a shrinking share of our employment. It's still, by the way, about 20-25% of our GDP. We are the most productive industrial nation on the planet. We do that with less than 9% of the workforce. So what we've done is we've layered on top of it the knowledge economy, driven by the creative class. And this is why George Mason is so important to not just the state economy, but to this local economy, to be educating the creative class. The next economy, I think, to layer on top of the knowledge economy is the experience economy, where you add value by the experience that you're providing. Tourism is the obvious example. That's the largest industry on the planet right now. That's an experience economy. Two-thirds is going to Paris or Manhattan, to great walkable urban places. And then you ask, well, how's it going to affect us? Well, retail stores become more of the experience economy. And the best model right now is Apple. Apple came out with Apple stores about 8-10 years ago. There was great skepticism. This is when Disney stores were tanking. And they said, Steve Jobs doesn't know squat about retail and merchandising. How can he expect to do it when Disney is failing? He turned Apple stores into an experience. And it is mobbed all the time. He turned retail clerks into computer consultants. Any of you that are in the retail business know that, you know, grocery stores do about $800 per square foot per year. Macy's does about $600. A jewelry store sells very expensive small things in a very small space. They do about $1,500 per square foot per year. Apple stores have been doing $5,000 to $7,000 per square foot per year. So both the knowledge economy and the experience economy is demanding walkable urban places. So what we've begun to see over the last 20 years is that pendulum's been swinging back as our downtowns have been reviving, as suburban town centers have revived, and as we're seeing the conversion of drivable suburban places like, Tyson's, attempting to become walkable urban. Who'da thunk? Now, we know who to blame for this. We know who's driving this. It's the damn kids. It's their fault. It's the millennials that are driving this. And you can tell this best by television shows. If you think back, you old farts out there like me, that thinking about back in the 50s, 60s, and 70s to Leave It to Beaver and Dick Van Dyke and the Brady Bunch, all set in the drivable suburban splendor. Television does more consumer research than any industry. They get Nielsen feedback weekly. They're a reflection of our aspirations. Most people watching Leave It to Beaver lived in walkable urban cities, but they were aspiring to drivable suburbanism. Today, though, fast forward to what our kids have been raised on. Seinfeld, Friends, Sex and the City, Two Broke Girls, all set in walkable urban places. The only setting in a drivable suburban place that I can remember is Desperate Housewives. And there might be a reason why they are desperate. So this is what the rising generation is, in fact, aspiring to. Now, there are other reasons. Baby boomers become empty nesters, become retirees. They downsize. And many of them downsize to walkable urban places. They don't want to cut the lawn. They want the excitement of walking to 40, 50 restaurants within walking distance of their home. In fact, the National Association of Realtors survey shows that the baby boomers' number one place that they want to retire to is a small town, sort of like Fairfax. When you add those two up, the demographics are really driving this. That when gray hairs were growing up, 50% of all households had school-aged children in the household. 50% were singles and couples. Today, it's only 25% of households have children in them. 75% are singles and couples. But now look at the marginal growth in households over the next 20 years. Just what we're going to add. And only 14% of household growth is going to be families with children. 86% are singles and couples as the baby boomers become empty nesters and retire, and as the rising generation are having fewer babies. The other thing is sheer boredom. People discredit boredom as a major motivator. Out here in Fairfax County, 20 years ago, if you had a choice in where you lived, you could live in a single family home or a single family home. And if you wanted to go shopping, you can go to a 1980s strip mall or a 1990s strip mall. There was no choice. Americans want choice. And as I mentioned earlier, the creative class is demanding to be in walkable urban places. And they want to not just live there, they want to work there within walking distance. And then finally, it's just the expense of maintaining a fleet of cars to participate in society. That if you look at how much we spend on transportation, 19% of household income goes towards transportation, second highest category of household spending. Almost all of that is for cars, to maintain and insure and service and park a car. And fuel is a very small part of the total cost. When you disaggregate the data, drivable suburban households spend 25% of their household income maintaining a fleet of cars to participate, while walkable urban households only spend 9%. That 16% difference is about $700 to $800 billion of spending per year. That money, when it's spent in cars, almost all of it leaves the metropolitan economy. If it's not spent at all, and it's invested in housing or retail sales or education, or maybe that most un-American of all things, savings, that money stays local. AAA tells us one car costs $9,200 per year after tax. You drop one car out of your household, because most people want to have a car in their household. Just drop one car. You could convert that. If you converted it to a mortgage, you increase your mortgage capacity by $150,000. Cars always depreciate. Houses generally appreciate. It's a great way to build household wealth. One of the best signs that the times are changing is that, and there's been an iron law in economics over the last 100 years, that as GDP goes up or flattens out during a recession, as GDP goes up, say 3%, vehicle miles traveled, the most common way of measuring how much we travel, how much we drive, goes up the exact same percentage. It's a one-to-one relationship, and that relationship held for 100 years until the mid-90s, when these trends began to take effect. We are beyond peak driving in this country. We continue to add about 0.7 or 1% to our population each year, but we peaked in our driving in 2004. On average, we're driving about 10% less per capita in absolute terms. The young people, their peak driving, these are 16 through 34, their peak driving was 2001, and they're now down 33% in real terms. And you can probably just, you know, ask yourself, ask your friends, how many of your teenagers are getting their driver's license? Many are postponing, many don't have any desire. And that's because the knowledge economy doesn't need cars and trucks. Building these walkable urban places is fundamentally different than what we learned as we were building drivable suburban places. That I liken it to that we in real estate got really good, and the planning officials and all the engineers got really good at driving NASCARs. NASCARs, you go straight or turn left. They're engineered only to turn left, which is somewhat ironic politically, given NASCARs. And you're going about 150 miles an hour. We have to learn how to fly fighter jets, which is going straight, turn right, turn left, go up 5 miles or crash and burn in seconds, going 600 miles an hour while you're being shot at. It's a fundamentally different skill set. It's really important to note, as you look at the future of this town, is that virtually every lesson you have learned building drivable suburban places do not apply to building walkable urban. It's a different construction type, it's a different financing type, it's a different zoning type, it's a different risk characteristic. Everything is different. So all the rules of thumb you know will just get you into trouble. We've also now learned that as you add more urbanism, a new apartment building gets built downtown, new retail comes in, a movie theater moves in, it just gets better. Unlike out with drivable suburban, who gets there first wins. In a walkable urban place, you just add more, and it starts an upward spiral of value creation. More sales, more property taxes, more rent, more urban excitement, it's safer. Space that was considered almost worthless, alley-fronting space, becomes great retail space, real characterful little alleys. Otherwise, you know, in Britain, they call them muses. That upward spiral, you still have to worry about something here, which is affordable housing, social equity. That we have a massive affordable housing crisis in this country, especially as we're building more and more walkable urban places. Because walkable urban places, as I'll show you in just one second, are unbelievably expensive now. They weren't 20 years ago, they are now. It's a reflection of the economy, it's a reflection of pent-up demand. That's why they're so expensive. We don't have enough of this stuff. So this is how the walkable urban places in DC have laid out, looking at the walkable urban places in this 5.5 million metropolitan area. They fall into six categories. There's downtown, and then there's downtown adjacent places. 360 degrees around downtown, we're seeing walkable urban places emerge. And most of these places 20 years ago, you wouldn't be caught dead in. Then again, you might have been. Then urban commercial, Adams Morgan, Columbia Heights, H Street. These are places that were all dead 20 years ago. Now they're vital, walkable urban places playing a role in the regional economy. Then you move out to the suburbs. This is the one that you're in. In fact, you can see yourself 21 down there on the lower left-hand part of the slide. These are suburban town centers that were laid out before the automobile. They have a nice grid of streets, buildings right up to the sidewalk, and what was a negative 25 years ago, as far as the market was concerned, a walkable urban place, is now the reason it's coming back. Then here's the biggie. This is the conversion of strip commercial regional malls, drivable suburban places, into walkable urban. And the monster of them all is, of course, Tysons. Tysons is going to break up into four different walkable urban places. Each metro stop is going to have its own character and its own strategy, and there's huge sums of money going in. And the property owners got the concept of transportation drives development because the property owners are paying for one-third of the cost. Nearly $2 billion they're paying for metro coming there and for all the other transportation improvements like putting in sidewalks. And then finally, the sixth category is greenfield sites. Rest in town centers, the best model in the country. 80% of these 46 walkable urban places are rail transit served. That's not a coincidence. But 20% are not. The fact that you don't have metro does not condemn you. It just says that you don't have a major asset that these others have. But you know, Shirlington is a bus served walkable urban place. So it can happen without rail transit. The other thing is that these 46 add up to 17,500 acres. That's less than 1% of the total land mass. On average, they're 408 acres in size. Your downtown area is about 450 acres in size. They have to be compact to be walkable. So a few examples from this region, of course, downtown, very exciting place today, but 20 years ago, you all know that its brand was dull, dangerous, and dirty. There were 90 surface parking lots in downtown DC 20 years ago. Today, there's one awaiting a hotel near the convention center. It's now the second best downtown in the country. It generates a net profit to the city of $1 billion per year. Here is Capitol Riverfront, down by the ballpark. 12 years ago, there were 19 murders in Capitol Riverfront. Now it is just thriving. Harris Teeter just opened up. Whole Foods, it's just about to open up. It's a very exciting place. Then U Street, Shaw, obviously, you know, the 14th Street corridor. Last year, 20 new restaurants opened. It's the hip new place, and this was burned out back in 1968. Now, the suburban town centers, probably the best model is Bethesda. And you really need to understand Bethesda because they've done a lot of good things. That office tower there, get $60 per square foot rents, which is stunning rents, some of the highest in the country. 15 years ago, that was the Bob's Big Boy drive-thru. Silver Spring, the most integrated place. Black and white, it's really thriving. Of course, the Discovery Channel is, in fact, located there. The reason Discovery went there is that the founder of Discovery went to high school in Silver Spring. He should be in New York or Los Angeles. He picks Silver Spring, of all places, to move his headquarters. Now, Arlington. Arlington is the most important suburban model in the country. It's got more examples of urbanizing places than any place else in the country. Lots of lessons to be learned from Arlington. This is a shot in Clarendon of the old Sears store when it closed back in the 80s. The walkable urban places in that county represent 11% of their land. And back then, it was 20% of the tax base revenues and falling for obvious reasons. This is what it looks like today. You're looking at an Apple store, the Whole Foods, and $600 per square foot condos on top. Today, that 11% of land in Arlington generates 55% of their tax revenues. Virtually all of their growth in tax revenues is coming from that 11% of their land. The really great thing, and something for you to learn here, is that two blocks north and two blocks south, it feathers back to single family housing. They have 100% price premium. Why? Because they can live in suburban splendor and walk to 40 restaurants, walk to Metro, maybe walk to work. It's the best of two worlds. And that's what the single family neighborhoods outside of downtown, near the university, can experience, will experience, as this kind of urbanism takes place. So here's downtown White Flint, another great model. On the right, of course, is what it looks like today. On the left is what's coming. And much of the transportation improvements on Rockville Pike will be paid for by the property owners as well. It's a private-public partnership driven by private dollars. In the lower left is a new apartment building that's rising on a former strip retail parking lot. It will undoubtedly contribute to the tax base in Montgomery County. Reston Town Center has a 60% price premium over the business parks all around it, because people are willing to pay 60% more to live, to occupy retail space, to occupy office space, to live in high-density walkable urban than a business park or a strip mall. The other thing we've now learned through a study that we released at GW in June is we've found a correlation between walkable urban places and the education of the workforce. Those people over 25 years of age, what percentage of them have graduated from college? In the upper right-hand corner of this chart are six little green dots. These are the most walkable urban places in the country. Washington leads the way. Metro Washington is number one. Boston, New York, Chicago, Seattle, San Francisco are those six places. Those six places have far more college-educated folks in the workforce. And those six places have 39% of their workforce is college-educated. Here in DC, it's 48%. When you compare it to the 10 lowest-ranked walkable urban places, the Orlandos, the Tampas, the Phoenixes, their average is 29% of their workforce has their college degree. Very significant change. Then we found out, we know that there's a connection between the education of the workforce and the GDP per capita. The more the education, the higher the GDP. So therefore, we found that the six most walkable urban places in this country, that their GDP per capita is over $60,000. The lowest 10 is $44,000. That's a 38% premium. That's the gap between Germany and Romania. It's the difference between a first world country and a second world country. This is significant as far as economic growth. So we're seeing it as far as office space goes, of course. Walkable urban office space has a 75% price premium. In fact, what we're seeing now, there's rumors in the real estate industry, is that some business parks that were built 20 years ago do not see a future tenant in sight. 20-year-old business parks may either be repurposed or bulldozed because of this kind of a price premium, because that's what the market wants. Housing, of course, is the same way that walkable urban houses in this region, 71% price premium on a price per square foot basis. Somebody earlier mentioned WalkScore. Go to walkscore.com, put your address in, and you'll get a ranking of between 0 and 100. 5, 10, 20 WalkScore means you have to drive every place. 70 or higher, you've got a walkable urban place. Here in Metro DC, every one walk score point over 70 adds $20 per square foot to the value of your house. It's that powerful. Now, it's important when you're planning these places to recognize the importance of place management. It's a brand new field that these downtowns, and like your downtown, needs to be managed 24/7. Certainly the public sector has a big role to play. They set the table. The private sector has a huge role to play. They're investing $15 in investment for every $1 coming from the public sector. But the place management organization is really key. What place management does is that it first starts with clean and safe. Make the place clean and safe, so dealing with the alleys and making sure lighting comes to the alleys and clean them up and have wire contact with the police. They aren't policemen, but they are connected with the police. Then you move into running festivals, and you move into maybe managing the parks. They manage all the parking in the walkable urban place. They might become a catalytic development organization, taking land and replanting it, rezoning it, and then putting it back into the private sector. This is a hyper-local level of governance. I didn't say government. Governance that, generally speaking, the private sector runs. So here's one of the best examples of a place management, and I know it might be too big for you to comprehend because it's Bryant Park on 42nd Street in Midtown Manhattan. But it's such a great model. 15 years ago, Bryant Park had a $250,000 budget for the City Parks Department in New York City. For that, the city got the best drug dealing center in Midtown. It was known as Needle Park, and all the property owners turned their back on Bryant Park. It was really nasty. The private sector took hold of it through a business improvement district. They rebuilt the place, all with private sector dollars. Their budget now is $12.5 million. 90% of it is raised on the 6-acre park. They have activities constantly. It's open to everybody. And it's the best park in the country. In conclusion, two things to toss out. One is, what has Arlington taught us? Because again, from the urbanization of the suburbs, you must understand Arlington in this country. First is, you can have the best of both worlds. Arlington's proved it. Suburban splendor, great walkable urban, right next to one another. Second is that Arlington County has measured constantly. They're getting feedback from all the citizens to make good decisions, to see what's working, see what's not working. They started an affordable housing strategy very early. If you don't get in front of it, your very success and that upward spiral is going to make it very expensive to address that problem. The walkable urban development in Arlington has absolutely, and on a per capita basis, reduced traffic. Virtually all of their growth is by people walking, biking, and taking metro. You can't use the excuse that, oh my God, we can't build here because it's going to create too much traffic. It goes the other way. The other thing is that you're going to need less and less parking. Early on in the redevelopment process of a suburban town center, you need a lot of parking. You need basically suburban parking ratios. 20 years into it, it drops from 4 parking spaces per 1,000 square feet down to under 1. Invest up front in parking, you won't have to invest in the future. And by the way, 20 years from now, those parking decks become cash cows. High density housing, both rental and for sale, have very small school age child generation rates. Place management is absolutely crucial. Now, Arlington was a little late getting to the place management game, but now virtually all of their 8 walkable urban places have place management. And it's never too late to start. I'm always reminded of that great Garrison Keillor quote that in the long run, all solutions are temporary. A little to-do list. First, you have to be conscious about this. Consciously have the intention to do this. This is not easy. This is not something that you can just kind of dream and hope it happens. There's a lot of work that needs to be done. You must have the intention to do this. This is where it all starts. You should tour a lot of the national models. You've got a great opportunity here of a university and a historic town center with a great grid of streets, historic buildings. And you can take a look at Ann Arbor. And you might want to consider the possibility of 2 walkable urban places. One at the campus and one downtown. Ann Arbor, University of Michigan, State Street is the student walkable urban place. About a half mile away is Main Street. They're both booming, and in between is exploding with growth. You need to establish boundaries, which you've done. It's important to put firm boundaries. I used to have horses, and I built this corral for these horses, and the rules were no going outside of the corral. But inside the corral, it's a free market. Go to it. So we want to keep all that activity confined. You have to have the right zoning in place. I've done 12 walkable urban real estate projects as a developer. Every single one of them, when I proposed them, it was illegal. Millions of dollars and years of brain damage to get the laws changed to allow a mixed-use walkable urban place to be built. Plan for a streetcar. 100 years ago, this region was riddled with streetcars. We are 3 times wealthier on a per capita basis than they were 100 years ago. You can afford a streetcar, and the private sector should help pay for it. If you can capture 18% of the upside, as far as what the private sector gained by building the streetcar, you can pay for the entire thing. That's how they paid for it 100 years ago. We should be doing the same thing today. Place management organizations, really consider them. You might want to do it publicly, you might want to do it privately. Obviously, your choice. Research, analyze, listen, constant feedback. You've got to know what your consumer is telling you. Continue to track the increases in quality of life. Measure, measure, measure. Because if you don't measure, you can't manage. So, what happened with Back to the Future? Here is that near distant future where downtown Hill Valley has come back. And you look, you know, the plaza is now, once again, the center of town, just like you're building your plaza in downtown. All the buildings have been rebuilt, and many of them have been increased in their density. They got everything right here except one thing. They always promise flying cars. We never get flying cars. This episode, or this clip, takes place in October of 2015. Get to it. Thank you very much.